Another one that's really critical, this idea that keeps coming up about territories. Let me tell you what's profoundly wrong with this idea that we're going to carve up the nation into territories. It's this. In any community, whether you're talking about Capitola or North America, the shortage, the scarcity, is in the number of people that really want to help people and have fun doing it, not in how many people can be made clients. The shortage is in professional trainers, not clients. We do not have a fixed number of clients out there. If I take a poll, and how many would like to be trained at CrossFit there? See, it's 75 people. So therefore, I can only have half of a trainer. It takes about 150, you're done. You have 150 clients, you're no longer effective. You've got to do something different. You've got to leverage yourself. We'll come back to that too. It doesn't work that way. Clients are made. So Dan says, I don't need a trainer. I don't want a trainer. I've never had a trainer. And then hour after talking to me, he's going, but I'm going to train with this guy. Every one of my clients is that way. Nicole was not looking for a trainer. Annie was not looking for a trainer. They not only did they not want to be trainers, they weren't looking for trainers. Clients are made like a watch is made. They're not harvested like plums. You have to make them. And you go into every community, every environment. Nicole goes into Starbucks and comes out not with just a 10-shot gigantic, but the district managers as clients. I asked her at one point, she was sitting on that third step. She'd been with us for a few months and was just brimming over with clients. I go, Nicole, how do you get clients? You know what she said to me? It was the stupidest answer ever imaginable, and I was ecstatic when I heard it. What do you mean? And I'm like, perfect, never mind. Sorry, bothered. She had no idea how she got clients. But you know what I saw in her work, and I see it in Annie's work, I see it in Lauren's work, I see it in Steve's work. She loves communicating what it is she knows about human movement to others. Now, I'll tell you right now, if you don't find yourself in a state where, man, I would do this for free, I'll tell you, you're not going to have success. Now, I told Craig Patterson, when he's like, man, dude, I don't know how this whole thing's going to work out. I'm really nervous. I'm putting my life on the line. I'm getting this big building. I'm taking out all these loans. And I'm like, me neither. I got no idea. I don't know how this is working. I don't know what you're doing or what I'm doing. And I go, but I tell you this. If the shit hits the fan and everything ends up upside down, you and I will go somewhere. We'll get fucking jobs at McDonald's. And on our breaks, we'll be out in the parking lot by the dumpster with broomsticks teaching people how to clean and deadlift, and we'll be happy. And you know, he said, well, I'm like, yeah, we can't lose. And Laura and I have always had that attitude. The things we did day in, day out, from when there was four or five of us in a one-bedroom apartment in town to a current state of affairs, it was always fun. And I really loved working with you, Jimmy. It was a blast. I've had for hour at a time, week at a time, other jobs. We are like, Jesus Christ, when's lunch? And in this line of work, I never found myself doing that, and I never found the good trainers doing it. So you gotta enjoy yourself, and if you're not, figure out how. If you can't, go into something else. Because I've never seen anyone, and one of the beautiful things about being a trainer with a large client base is I have billionaire clients, several of them. I have destitute clients, I have Olympic medalist clients, I've seen people from all walks of life. What I've seen is that anyone that you'd call successful, whether it was their Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu world champion or a multi-billionaire, what they did is they're passionate about what they're doing. They're fucking in love with it, and they would do it if they had to pay to do it. And once you get that attitude, like, man, I'd do this for free, look out, you don't want to compete against that. For you, it's a job, and the other guy, it's what gets his rocks off, you're done. For you, it's drudgery. So find a way to love it or get out. Realize that clients are made, not harvested. You don't pick them from the tree. You take someone who never dreamed of having a trainer and you get them a trainer. You become their trainer. There's an intimacy and involvement. You know, like I understand that in psychology, psychiatry, you don't sleep with your clients. I did mine. I slept with them. I had two children with her and launched a revolution. You wouldn't believe the entanglements that happen in this world. If I train you, Dan, and don't know what you do for a living, I'm not a good trainer. Yeah, I've got people like, so I know my business, blah, blah, blah. Tell me about you. Who's your favorite client? Okay, great. What does she do for a living? I don't know. But, dude, you fucking suck is why you're not doing well. How can you spend the time you do with people, their hopes, their fears, their aspirations, their children, their grandchildren, their wants and desires, every aspect of their being is your business. That's true of coaching. If you're a soccer coach and one of your kids is depressed and you don't know it, you're an inadequate coach. If he's afraid of the dark and you don't know it, you're missing something. We get in their head, we get in their skin, we get in their lives, we're a part of their families. And it's a wonderful thing. I've never seen another walk of life where, you know, now you can be a psychiatrist, sure, you hear some intimate shit, but you're not there at the 50th wedding anniversary. You're not there at the bar mitzvah. You're not there, you know, you're not there for those critical moments. We always are. We always
have in touch, okay?
We hung, we lived, we died, we cried, we've done everything with our clients on a very personal level. And I wouldn't trade this work for anything in the world. Now, there's somewhat a process in training where we go from kind of we're kind of increasingly seeing this natural division. And what we want to do is make these distinctions less artificial, more natural. Level one trainer, it's all about mechanics. Do you know that the shoulder should be over the hand in the dead? Do you know the back must be arched? Check, good, mechanics. Level two, can I effectively impart that material to others? And level three, it's about leverage. I told you that, you know, a great CrossFit trainer with two clients isn't as good as Richard Simmons with a million. This level three is about leveraging what it is you do, what it is you know, not just to one, not just to two, but to get out of the spinning plates mode of things. You know the vaudeville trick where we're spinning plates and we're working all directions? But to be able to actually extend what it is you know, what you can do to the masses. And that involves a website. If you're a trainer without a website, you're not reaching the number of people you possibly could. All kinds of media. How many of you considered writing for a local paper? You ought to. I did. It was a great experience. You want to leverage yourself so that in a 40-hour work week, you can reach an infinite number of people with what it is that you are passionate about. And so what's funny is on this level three domain, we kind of end up now into this kind of media mode. And so if you tell me, you know, I told you this line I don't like. I'm not interested in making money. I'm not interested in reaching the masses. I'm not interested in the internet. You're losing it. You're losing the opportunity. Because the time will come quickly where you're like, when we found this, we were working from 5 a.m. When we were at Gold's Gym here in town, Lauren and I were in the gym at 5 a.m. We would see clients till about 11 or 12. We had this 100-square-foot office that we were paying $500 a month for, about seven times the going rate. We'd close the door and lay down on the floor and sleep. And clients would come in at 3 or 4 in the afternoon, and we would be there until 9 or 10 o'clock at night, ride our bikes on, and do this 7 days a week. And you know what we said? I would love this. I mean, there's good money in that. There ought to be good money in working 100-hour weeks. There are. But there's a better way. And the first step in that was group classes. Group classes. But you know what? We wouldn't have been successful. We've yet to see, but maybe one or two exceptions, anyone find success in groups without first mastering the individual. And I've written on this, I don't know where it was, but we've been to this before. But Jolie, what I want to do is I want to train you so well that you're like, God, he's my trainer. And I come to you one day and I go, Jolie, I've got good news and bad news. Bad news, you're going to have to split your hours. Sorry, but here's the good news. You're going to dig Dan. He's really a cool guy. And I'm going to drop your rate. And what I want you to do is just for me, try it. And I had, of a client base of 70 or 80 people, I had one balk at that. And it turns out she makes everyone miserable who trains her under any circumstances. So but what they find is that when Jolie and Dan are here, Jolie, do you get any less attention with two than you did one-on-one? No. In fact, if you're doing a good enough training job, your clients aren't yearning for more attention from you. What they want is less. Because when I'm in your face, it's only 30% of the time to tell you how wonderful you are. The rest of the time it's like, what the fuck, why are your heels coming off the ground? Why is your back arch? Where are your shoulders? Don't look down, look up. And I've worked Dan and Jolie to the point where I'm doing just as good a job with the two of them as I did with the one of you. If there's any diminution in the quality of the training at all, I'm not ready for to do two-on-ones. But what we've seen is if you start with one-on-ones until your schedule's packed, now, second layer, add them back in. I don't have available time. Stick them in on top of someone else and work them together. You will then likely be able to grow into that ability in two-on-ones. Two of them, one of you. And you push this out into running five or six classes a day of 10 to 15 people, 5 days a week, what you're going to find is that you have a fat and comfortable six-figure income doing something that you fucking love. And I don't know anyone that has that like we do, like the trainers. And it's the most natural, organic thing you ever do. I have a good number of physician friends, a family full of physicians, a lot of physician clients, and we've got maybe 15 or 20 physician trainers and about half a dozen of physician affiliates. And what they will tell you is that we are fulfilling the dream that drew them into medicine. Without the malpractice insurance, the lousy hours, and the bodily fluids squirted into your face at random.
Well, I work for the drug industry, and this is fulfilling, sort of should make it obsolete.
Yes.
We were talking about, Dutch and I were talking about that. We'd like to have it obsolete. That's why I'm into this. Yeah.
You want to help someone just at the core of their being, the essence of who and what they are, and you can do it right here doing what we're doing.
Jason.
Right here doing what we're doing. And all we're doing is just helping people and having fun. Do you understand that me talking to you right now is a perfect extension of the one-on-one where I told you to start? Because see, I got my schedule so fucking full that now what I have to do is I have to help you, help him, help them, because I just don't have enough of me to go around. And all of you want to be on that same path. Leverage yourself, leverage your efforts, develop your website, share what it is you do with people, have fun doing it. Talk to your local TV station. Talk to anyone that will listen to you talking about what you do, but only if you love it. If you get up there and go, hey, I'm going to deliver a lecture on Krebs citric acid cycle, you're dope. But if you can get up and go, man, I want to show you something really cool. It's a fucking squat. It's unbelievable. It's the simplest, most overlooked thing in the world. And if you feel and believe that and can express that with passion, people are going to follow you anywhere. And they'll throw money at your feet. Questions? These are the intangibles. We're going to work this into a curriculum. We'll make it accessible to all of you as it's refined and honed. But I'm increasingly on edge that it's not about a better deadlift. It's not about a perfect clean. It isn't. It isn't. It's about having it at the 60-70% mark and then driving it to the masses and having a big smile on your face. You and your clients together will figure out how to do better cleans.